to say thank you for allowing us to go and letting us go. This was my X number of times going, and every year I come back changed, every year I come back renewed and revived, and I really enjoy going every year. It's something that I look forward to until I go back next year. So the one that spoke out to me the most at Forward this year was actually a lady. So she said that God isn't waiting on our strength. He already has it. So we often ask God, you know, why? Why us? Why can't I do this by myself? We always want to do stuff on our own strength. But we weren't called here to do things by ourselves. We don't need to do things by ourselves, and that's not what God has. And it says that our strength is not enough because we can't do it alone. We try to run from God, but God is in every situation all the time. We can't run from God. We can't hide from God. So why not be honest with ourselves to be honest with God? And so she talked about how breakthrough is in worship. I personally love worship. And in worship, that's when you communicate with God. And so this was just, you know, a couple points that she said in her message. But one verse that she spoke from was Psalms 46:10. And it says, "Be still and know that I am God." And that just goes back to trying to do everything on our own strength. So about a year ago, many of you know, I actually went through a very life-changing experience. And I was a senior in high school about to graduate. And I went to the doctor and they said, "You have a brain tumor and you're going to have brain surgery." And I was like, "God, why me? Why now?" You know, like, I've always been this healthy child. I've never had a broken bone, never been to the doctor, never done anything. And I'm going to say right now, I thank God for a brain mama. And so throughout this whole conference, you know, it just, you know, resonated me with it. She said, "Be still and know that I am God." Because we could have asked God all these questions, but we didn't. We were still, and we knew that God was himself. We knew that God was going to be faithful. I went in on Thursday and came out on Monday when I was supposed to be there for over a week. God shows up in the midst of any and everything. As long as we are still and we know who he is and when he will be there and everything. But the key to that is be still. Be still and wait on God and trust in God. And that's kind of all I have from this trip. So again, thank you for letting us go, and thank you for all your prayers and support along the way.
All right, so the one thing that spoke to me was just like Jake read to death when he said, put your phone down and look me in the eye. We always look to other people to accept who we are, but we only need to trust in the God the Father. We need to look to Him for who we are, because in the end, that's your ticket to heaven. Amen. This is here on earth. Yeah, you can connect people. You can be friends with people, but in the end, who talks to you, who you hang around with, that doesn't set anything up there. That sets down here, and that can send you down there.
Start over, you got to this morning?
Good.
Well, I'm blessed because I had my buddy, Chris, and his son with me that were down there at U. We had such an awesome, awesome time. And I'm just blessed because I was on the journey with a lot of friends and family, and the Spirit of the Lord was in the house down there. I'm going to tell you, it was on down there. I'm just saying, we had such a good time. People were shouting, getting saved by the Lord, and that's most important, that they got saved and they get to come home to a good church like this right here and be saved with the Spirit of the Lord, and it keeps on moving forward to the other people in the world that love God as much as we do. And I just want to thank everybody. Massey, Pastor Dan, all of y'all, thank y'all so much. And I just had a blessed time with y'all, and it's been a good year so far, so let's keep on going.
Hey, I want to thank all the ones, the chaperones and stuff that went through to for the nights at 1 o'clock and 2 o'clock and probably 3 o'clock sometimes that they stayed up with these kids. So I really appreciate the chaperones that went and helped us out. It was an awesome time, awesome time. Yeah, you got something about Vacation Bible School?
Hi, good morning. My name is Amy Worrell. I just had a couple announcements about Children's Church as well as Vacation Bible School coming up. I work this weekend on a schedule for the entire year of people that will be working with your little ones during our Children's Church on Sunday mornings. So we have a team of 5 people that are working and are going to be prepared to just bring the Lord, the word to of your children through the Lord on Sunday morning. So I just want to let you know who those people are because it takes a lot of dedication. And that is Lucy, Stephanie, Mandy and Josh, Amanda Reyes, who's joining our team, and myself. We are currently doing a series that I have purchase called Surfs Up. It's a 10-week series, so your children will be learning something, and it'll keep working and being together in consensus for 10 weeks. Each day that your children come to Children's Church, they'll get a letter that's supposed to be for parents to say, you know, while you're in the car, ask them this, or while you're eating dinner, ask the children this, so they can reflect back on what they've learned during Children's Church. So thank you for those that have given your time and will be willing to help with that. If I haven't seen you yet this morning, I'm going to give you a snapshot, a pre-look at your lesson, so that you will have an idea of what you're going to be teaching and sharing for your particular Sundays. When school starts, we're going to be going into another series called What's in Your Backpack? It's a 4-week series getting back into school. And then we'll go into a different theme and topic for a year. Today, after we do praise and worship, I will be gathering the little ones and be working with the little ones this Sunday. Vacation Bible School, as you know, is coming up. We're going to be having our kickoff on July the 28th, which is a Sunday afternoon, and commencement will be that Thursday, August the 1st. If you are willing and able and would like to be a part of our Vacation Bible School next Sunday, the 14th, I would really love to meet with that team and my leaders and everybody so we can get on the same page and go over some things before our big kickoff on the 28th. As a matter of fact, today I'm leaving after church and going to New Life Church in Rocky Mount, who's already had Vacation Bible School in the wild, and they're donating a lot of their decorations, which is such a blessing. Southside Baptist Church here in our community is also sharing and going to be helping us with decorations. If you are able, I'd like to start decorating the Wednesday before, which will be Wednesday the 24th. I know that Stephanie will be out here, Lucy helps, but if you are willing to come help and are able to do that, that would be amazing because it takes us several days to get ready for that. I already met with my kitchen crew, Tim, and some of us others got together and figured out our menu, what we're serving, our ingredients, our shopping list, so we are on go with everything we need to do. I know a ago, we showed a little promotional video of another church sharing their vacation Bible school, which this one, and I promise it's short, it's about 2 minutes, is actually Lifeway's promotion for Vacation Bible School. And I do want to let you know that next year, we'll set the date soon so I can announce that on Thursday we end. Next year, our theme is called Concrete Cranes. It's all about construction and trucks and bulldozers, and it's, you know, I can't wait to buy my park hat and construction boots and wear my flannels and jeans, because that's typically what I like to wear. So it's going to be all about construction next year. So this is a 2-minute video. Please tell people, share on Facebook, get the word out in the community, because we want this place to be filled with children coming to our Vacation Bible School. So this one is real quick, and it is in the wild. Thank you.
Meeting place, Lord, this big, that it can continue to grow, Lord, and we can continue to
bring lost ones in. But Father, I just want to make sure that we know that we're the church, not the building. And we thank you for this time that we can come together, Lord. Your word says, fail not to assemble yourself together. So it's important that you put that in the Bible, that we come together to be trained, to be taught, to be disciples of your gospel. Lord, we thank you for what's going on in the youth building right now, Lord. When they start teaching over there, they will teach them to come here and understand what the pastor preaches. And to disciple them as well, that they can go back in their schools to teach and preach and testify what God has did for them. We ask you now, Lord, that we give, Lord, we're going to give as just like you give us, Lord. So we pray everything that is said, everything that's done today, Lord, is going to be uplifted to your kingdom. Father, we take this money that's given, Lord, and it's going to support the kingdom of Kingdom International, Lord, that we will reach out beyond these walls. We're going to reach out through social media. We're going to reach out through technology. We're going to reach out with our voice that Jesus loves you. This I know, for the Bible tells us so. And we thank you for that. In Jesus' name. Everyone said,
amen.
Amen.
Let's all stand. Thank you.
That is where my hope is found. And that is where our chains are broken in His presence. I want no straps. I don't want any straps. Come on, church, no chains. But fire. Come on, say it again. I need fire. And no straps. I want them to keep playing and obeying the Holy Spirit. And I want to explain something to you. As your eyes are closed, everyone's standing and your arms are lifted completely vertical to the heavens. I want to explain this in short, the best way I can as they're playing. I want to explain what God wants you to know about your praise and your worship. He told me and showed me last night a hot air balloon. He said, look it up, study it, explain it to the people, what a hot air balloon does, its function, and how it works. Come on, hands lifted as you're seeking heaven, seeking Christ, seeking fire with no straps. A hot air balloon works with fire. When the fire is turned on, the air is heated. And the balloon becomes full. And once the balloon is full, it will ascend. And God said to explain that to you today, that that is how, when you praise and when you begin to worship Christ, that is what happens to you. I don't know where the hot air balloon comes from, but it is from God. I take no credit, but He said to explain to you that you are the balloon. And it also said, over here on the pad, I'm not even going to go to them, but it has all the facts and everything I looked up. But there were certain key words that I underlined. I want you to continue to worship, continue to play. There is a part of the hot air balloon that is called the mouth. And see, the fire comes up through the mouth and into the balloon, and the air is heated. And see, we all know that hot air rises. But see, that balloon, it has certain functions. It allows people to be transported from here to there. And that's what your worship does. That's what your praise does in the spirit. Now, not the physical. It allows you to be transported from here to the throne room of God. I want to be transported. We got to have the fire. See, we're all full of hot air, right? But it's what we do with it.
Our mouths, and from our bellies, the
begins to come forth. And as we begin to give God praise, as we begin to give Him worship, as we begin to sing our song from our mouth, our balloons begin to fill up. And then we begin to ascend. He said, go to this book. And I want you to start just going through it. I went to this book this morning. And I started looking and looking. I didn't really know what I was looking for. But on page 33, it said, worship. Worshippers are like this. This was just my confirmation. It said, like hot air balloons. I just know that God has a message for you. He wants you to be worship warriors. He wants you to understand that nobody can sing your song for you. Nobody can do it for you. And I don't know about you, but I want to get to where He is. He's expecting us to move. And He will inhabit that. He will begin to work wonders and miracles. I need miracles. Come on. Somebody, I need wonders. Wonder working power and miracles in my life, in the present, right here, right now. Lift up your hands. I need my chains removed. I need my straps removed that I can ascend. I need fear to bow down and no more have control over me, my thoughts, and my life.
Set a fire down in my soul that I can't contain. I need a fire.
And no straps.
No straps.
No chains.
I want everyone to say, God,
God,
release me.
Release me.
You may be seated. Our children's church is heading over to the next building. As you entrust us with your children, we will prepare them for the second coming of Christ. And while they are departing, if you would turn with me to Zechariah in the Old Testament, chapter 11. Zechariah chapter 11 in the Old Testament. The message that I have for you from the Lord is found in this first verse here of three words. Open your doors. Open your doors. There's only one door that leads to your heart, but once you get into the heart of man, there are many closets and many rooms. But you have to open the door. Jesus understood the words of Zechariah because he said, I stand at the door and knock. If any man would open the door, I will come in and sup with him. And when you sup or you eat supper with someone, you sit around the table and you begin to discuss and talk about things in your life, about your life, and things that are part of life. So the Lord himself gives the command to Zechariah to speak to his people and tell them to open the doors. But the word door, before you can get to the doors, you have to open the door to your heart. If you look down at verse 4, this is what the Lord my God says, go and care for a flock that is intended for slaughter. Verse 4, this is what the Lord said, go and care for a flock that is tend for slaughter. The buyer will slaughter the sheep without remorse. The seller will say, praise the Lord, I am now rich. Does that sound something what, much like what Jesus said in Revelation when he gave the message to the seven churches? The last generation, the Laodicea, I am rich. I'm not poor. I do not sin. Matter of fact, Jesus gives the same description that Zechariah gives here. Zechariah has a double-fold law of prophecy here. He's speaking to Israel, but he's also speaking to the last remnant group, the church, in the last days. He didn't see it as Jesus saw it and as Jesus and John portrayed it to the world, but he saw a glimpse of it. Zechariah saw the church. He didn't know how to name it, but he described it to a T. But But Jesus goes a little bit deeper because he's the one that gives Zechariah these words. And the last message of the church and the Laodicea, we're rich. We're not poor. We have no need of nothing. And Jesus even told his people, his remnant, he said, you need to buy gold that's gone through the fire and been tried and come out pure. But the people would not listen. And then as we see the church age, as we know the seven churches in Asia begin to close out, we see a great picture that John sees of God in his wrath, as Zechariah will continue telling us what takes place. And he says of the things that are to come, that are not yet, but they shall be. But the problem is, you're living in the shall be. You're living right now. And when I get through this morning delivering the message that God has given me to give you, you're a few of the many congregations that are going to hear what I got to say this morning. But it's going to be your responsibility to go and tell the world what God has showed us and revealed to us. The problem, reason why preachers today are not prophetically in their preaching and in their teaching, because they're not connected. They're sermonized and they're doctrinized, and they're not spiritually connected to the fountain, to the river that flows with the truth of knowledge and the truth of the Spirit. That's why Jesus said, he that has an ear, let him hear what the Spirit says. You're not going to find God on the pages of books that were written by men of the natural. You'll find God that's hidden in the secret places to where he entrusted men of old that was moved on with the Holy Ghost. And they were trusted men that God trusted to encounter his Spirit and to bring forth the Spirit in written word and in a spiritual demonstration of his power. I want you to know that Zechariah here tells a beautiful description of our day. He didn't understand it. He just wrote about it, that it would come, and it's upon us right now. So this is what God tells him. He gives him here in verse 7. I want you to look here at verse 7. He says, so I cared for the flock and tended for slaughter, the flock that was oppressed. If you've ever lived in a time that we live in, everything is oppressed. Ain't nobody happy. Everybody's discouraged. Everybody has gone through hardships. And it's just oppression everywhere. Have you ever been felt like your back was pressed up against the wall? Or suppressed down, you wanted to go forward, but you couldn't, or something was pressing you down. I mean, Zechariah saw the big picture. And he goes, he said, then I took two shepherd's staffs. He goes up to the shepherds, and God is using him to speak prophetically, not only to Israel, but to the whole world. He said, I want you, Zechariah, to take two shepherd's staff, and I want you to name one favor, and the other one called union. Zechariah saw the church. He didn't even know what he saw. But favor, when you look at it, it means someone that God just picks out, pulls them out of nowhere, and says, I'm going to give you my blessings and my favor. When he found Abraham just minding his own business, he just shows up and he picks him and says, Abraham, I want to make you a father of many nations. So all of a sudden, Abraham received the favor of God. He didn't ask for it. He couldn't have earned it. He was living like everybody else. He was living in a corrupt society. But God says, you know what? I'm going to give my favor to whom I want to give my favor to. Even in the life of Moses, the great prince, the murderer. All of a sudden, God finds him in the wilderness running from his crime, running from his sins. Because he killed those Egyptians and covenants, and then they spotted him. Somebody spotted him. So he was running from his past, but he couldn't outrun God with his past. So God finds Moses, and he says, I want to give you my favor, but my favor is in exchange of you going to deliver my people out of Egypt. And he said, oh, no, get somebody else. See, that's what most of us do. When God says, I want you to do something for me, well, you start offering your excuses to God why you can't. And your can't is always, if you dig deep enough, you will find it. It was in your circumstances of experiences of your past. So therefore your past hinders you from your future, because you can't let go of the past. As Paul said, forgetting those things which are in the past, pressing toward the high calling in Christ, which is your future and your present ministry. You can't get beyond your failures, your experiences, whether it was intent or non-intent, whether it was direct or non-direct. You could not get beyond it. It is that which holds you down. Remember the song prophetically? Let the straps go. Break the strap and ascend. He talks about these two staffs. One is called favor. The other one is called union. The word union here is one that's been drafted into something. Been made a part of. You know, Jesus talked about it. I remember last year standing in the garden over to Jerusalem, standing in the Mount of Olives where my Lord stood, and as he looked over and saw Jerusalem, and he began to say, "Oh, Jerusalem, Jerusalem, how I have loved you, how I have tried to gather you unto myself, but you would not come to me. It was like a hen trying to gather her biddies. You wouldn't come to me and let me protect you. Instead, you wanted what you had present rather than what God had in store for you for the future, an everlasting kingdom." And I remember standing there, and I can understand now the drafting of the olive tree, how that the Lord himself drafted us into the covenant. He took it, he broke favor. You see, if anybody was the favorite of God, it was Israel. If any favorite child of God, we're called sons and daughters of God. If there was a favorite, Christ was the favorite one. But God broke him. He hung him on a cross and separated him from life to experience death. For the wages of sin is death. So he had to taste it. And the moment he tasted sin, the Father turned from him. And then that was the only time the Father ever turned from the Son. Because the Father cannot touch darkness or sin. But the Son bore it for us. He didn't have to save himself. He was already saved eternal, past, present, and future. He does it as a representation of mankind. God in the flesh. God came down and lived through the Son, through the human body. And God hung it on display for the whole world to see. And he goes and he shows this union here. How that out of Christ, that broken old covenant, that God was going to merge a church. But it doesn't stop with the church. Because in this church, this union that is now, as Paul said, there is now neither Jew nor Gentile, but we are now one in Christ. And not only has Israel showed the whole world a picture of God's amazing grace. Grace, when people say, we're in the grace dispensation. But can I tell you, grace has always been. God was gracious from day one in Genesis 3 when man fell. God was grace then. He was gracious to Adam and Eve. He gave them grace. Grace has always been. It's that we try to take God and we try to put him in section and dispensationalism and so forth. But you can't put God in time, because God is not time. God is eternal. You can't put him in a box. God is eternal. There is no time with God. Time is only with us. We're here today and we're gone tomorrow. But God is not time. So you can't say he's a dispensationalism God, because that puts him, he only is in certain sections. And God has always been. Before time was, God was there. God is bigger than human ideas, human theology, human philosophy. God is bigger than anything known to man. God is deep in himself. And as he reveals himself, we get a glimpse of him, not the big picture of him. Because if you had to stand in his presence right now, you would totally dissolve of his holiness. So Zechariah says that there was two staffs. There was one of favor, and there was one that was union. And he goes on, he gives us the description. If you continue to read on, this is what he said in verse 10. He said, I took the staff called favor and I snapped it in two, showing that I had revoked the covenant that I had made with all the nations. Notice the word nations. The word nations. Israel is a nation, but the church is made up of nations. Any nation or any people of any tribe, any tongue, any race that will call upon the name of the Lord, they will become to be a part of the covenant that God has made with the whole nations, and it's called the blood of the everlasting covenant. He said, I've come to save that which was lost, and that is the nations of all the world. And whosoever calls upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. But this is what he says. He goes to verse 11 and he says, that was the end of my covenant with them, and the suffering flock was watching me so that they knew that the Lord was speaking through my actions. Israel knows today that God had done something miraculously among them. They don't understand the fullness of it, but they know something has happened in their relationship and their covenant. They have been waiting for a long time for the God that their ancestors knew, that departed the Red Sea, that delivered Daniel in the lion's den, that delivered Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego out of the fiery furnace. They have been waiting a long time for the God of Elijah on Mount Carmel to show up again in the days when they need him. They've been waiting generation and generations to see another move of God like they have heard their forefathers say. They witnessed, they saw, and they believe. They're waiting, and they're about to see it. But before they see this miraculously miracle, they must go through much trouble and much tribulation. They're going to go through great rejection from all the nations of the world. And it's going to appear as no one loves Israel anymore. The reason you have the love of Israel and you see the love of Israel and all the nations is called the true church is still here. But when the true church is snatched up out of here, and I know you don't believe in the rapture, but evidently you don't believe in the teachings of Jesus. Because Jesus taught himself, I will take you out of the hour of great tribulation. I will rescue you before that moment comes. But those that do not watch and pray, they will miss my snatching away. And they will go through the great tribulation along with Israel. I know you find that strange to understand. Because you might be doctrinally encountered by theology, by denomination and philosophy. But when you come to the revelation of God, this here ain't about ideology. This is about true revelation, revealing himself to mankind so mankind is not caught by accident in the dark. Because he said no dark dwells in him, that only light, because he is the light. And the light came into darkness and it lit up the darkness. So if you want to know what's coming, then you get into the light and the light will show you what is about to happen. What you don't even understand is Zechariah is prophesying to you right now and you still ain't got it. But I want to just pull the cover back and help you see the light today. And what you do with that light is totally up to you. You can either stay strapped down or you can let the fire of God come out of you and all of a sudden you begin to sin, or you can sit and be miserable as hell, be oppressed, be disillusioned, be disappointed, don't trust nobody, don't believe in heaven or hell, don't believe that the way things are conditioned now is just another day. It's not just another day. It is a appointed day. God appoints days and weeks and hours and seasons and moments. Some of you will not forget this moment in this service, because this is the service that you're going to break free and be what he's called you to be. says, I want to show you something, Zachariah. I want you to speak to the people. I want you to turn with me to chapter 13 in Zechariah. I told you the message today is open your door and let him in, and he's going to do what I'm fixing to read to you. Zechariah understood exactly what was going to happen in 2018, 2019, and 2020. In chapter 13, on that day, a fountain will be opened to and for the dynasty of David. Some of you don't even know what the dynasty of David means and what, but I don't have time to get into it. But God says he's going to open a fountain for the dynasty of David and for the people of Jerusalem. The people of Jerusalem, the people of Israel. The dynasty of David is the tribe of Judah. And all that had been grafted into Judah by one olive tree, olive branch, Christ himself, and how he has redeemed all mankind to himself. And Christ makes up the dynasty of David, the son of David, the one that's going to sit on the throne of David, the one that has a kingdom without no end, and his government will rule creation for eternity, which not only is it in the millennial reign, but it is in an eternal state without no end. I can't comprehend that, because when I think about eternity, I think about it on the measure of mankind. You're here for 60, 70, 80, 90 years, and then you're gone. But God said he would open up a fountain. And the dynasty of David, the dynasty of David is not only the son that sits on the throne, but all of those who have part in his reign and his everlasting kingdom. I want you to understand that it's very important that when this fountain opens, this is why it's going to open. And it's opening right now. This is a fountain that will cleanse them from all of their sins and impurities or defilements. Of all their sins and their impurities. That sounds simple, but it's really complicated. It's very complex. God says that the Lord of heaven and armies, I will erase the idol worship throughout the land. A whole lot of idol worship is going on right now. And even the names of the idols will be forgotten. I will remove from the land both the false prophets and the spirit of impurity that came with them. And if anyone continues to prophesy, his own father and mother will tell him, you must die, for you have prophesied lies in the name of the Lord. And as he prophesies, his own father and mother will stab him and kill him. All that day, people will be ashamed to claim the prophetic gift. No one will be pretending to be a prophet by the wearing of prophet clothes. He will say, I'm not a prophet, I'm just a farmer. I am a Christian. I'm just this and I'm just that. I begin working as a farmer, as a boy, and I don't want to get caught up in all this mess. And if someone asks them, well, what about the wounds on your chest? And he will say, I was wounded at my friend's house. You know, this is the word that Jesus said one day when he was teaching, as he was beginning to offer Israel the kingdom. And he said that my own rejected me. So Jesus knows exactly what these words were said 500 years before it even took place. But I want to tell you something greater than that. Jesus said these very words, and so are you going to say these very words. I was stricken by the friends that I know. Then he said, awake, O sword, against my shepherd. The man who is my partner, said the heaven army. The Lord says this now. The ministers, the priests, they're supposed to be the Lord's partner. But now, because of the conditions, he's going to strike them down. And sheep will be scattered, and I will return against the lambs. I want you to know this morning that you are living in a prophetic timeline of the fulfillment of prophecy. Zechariah saw the big scope from his day all the way to John's day in Revelation 18:4. He saw the vision clearer than John saw it. John saw a glimpse of what Zechariah didn't see. Zechariah saw what John couldn't see because of the setting of the timing of the prophetic line. Zechariah saw in his day that the shepherds had begun to say things that the Lord didn't mean for them to say, but they said it anyway. But I want to break it down real simple so you can understand. Everybody under the sound of my voice has been waiting for this big revival to come, what they call the end time revival. But can I tell you the end time revival has already come? It's already swept the nations. You said, I don't think, you must have forgot what has happened the last 100 years in our history. If you remember anything about our history, the Great Reformation had done took place, and from the time of Luther and all the way up to the present mess that we've got in what we call evangelical Christianity, we have had a massive outpouring revival and a great awakening like no other generations prior or no other generation to come, because this generation that is to come is the predicting of the generation that goes into prediction of the judgments of God. So we have seen a great revival. Even Billy Graham himself is an icon of that revival, and almost 100 years of preaching and teaching. Even when he was a small young man, he knew he was called to preach. And I don't know of anyone that has reached the multitudes. I know there's the Wesleys, I know there's Moody's and Spurgeon's and Billy Sundays and all those, but there's never been one quite like Billy Graham that will sweep the nations, and in just thousands and millions would just run down the stadiums and give their life to Christ. And again, you haven't done your homework, but that was a mass evangelical movement in the Spirit of God from the times of 1948. And notice this here. Even Jesus, when he's preaching in Matthew 24, he gives us three great signs of things that are going to be going on when he returns to the earth. He said, he told his disciples, he said, listen, now I don't know the time, but I can tell you what's going to be going on in the times. He said, my Father alone knows the moment, the day and the hour, but he has given me the insights to what will be going on. And when you see these signs, then you know it is the time. Not the day nor the hour, but the incentive that something is about to happen. So even Jesus himself acknowledged that these ingredients had to be in place. Well, Zechariah, he said exactly what would be in place. He said that the shepherds and the preachers will be telling the people certain things, and it will lead them astray from God. It will lead them astray from Christ, and they will follow the prophets. They will follow the preachers and the shepherds, and they will lead them to disillusion. They will lead them into disappointments. They will lead them to where their faith no longer really matters. They don't care if they go to church or if they don't go to church. It don't matter no more, because they have been so hit so hard and so wounded by their friend's house. They're fed up with the mess. Most, at one time we had 80% of Americans that profess to be in Christ. And now you can't even get 20%, because nobody don't even want you to know they are attached to Christ, because the mess that represents Christ is far from the original Christ, and they just don't want to have a part in it. So they are neutral. You can't be neutral when the fire of God is in you. But you have been wounded, and that's why you take the back seat. I'm not a preacher, I'm just a farmer. I'm not a worship leader, I'm just a farmer. I'm not a Sunday school teacher, I'm just a farmer. I'm not a pastor, I'm just a farmer. I'm not a witness, I'm not a Christian, I'm just a farmer. God said he would smite the shepherds, and this would be his ultimate master plan. He said, because the shepherd begins to speak to the people. Jesus' last message to the Laodicea church was that the preachers were telling the people, have you ever heard the prosperity gospel?
Come on.
Have you ever heard the prosperity gospel? Accept Christ and you have wealth, fame, and popularity. Mm-hmm. But wait a minute, the only error with that is whatever God gives to one, he'll give to you. Because he's not a respectable person. So when one gets all the gold and you get the leftovers, God has a little balance of unfairness. But all these preachers in the last era have begun to create a new gospel and said, if you come to Christ, you'll be wept and you'll have this and you'll have that. But the problem is these shepherds are the ones that's got the mansions and the lands and the yachts and the houses and the big bank accounts, and I'm naming them all right on national television. Give, 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 and the more you give, the more they buy, and the more they set up treasures for themselves. And this is the shepherds that Zechariah saw coming into union that he said that would come, and they will lead the people to astray. Because when you follow a prosperity preacher, and then all of a sudden when you start getting a little bit of money, guess what your little bit of money does? It causes you to chase your idols, and your things become more important than your God, and your worship of worship dies down. You increase, he decreases, and all of a sudden you say the Lord is good. Praise the Lord, because he gives wealth. And your wealth has led you into idolatry, because when you worship anything more than you worship your Father or God of heaven, it becomes idolatry. There are three things that Jesus gives us in Matthew 24. He said that this generation will see the return of Christ. The first one was the budding of the fig tree. Israel became a nation in 1948. While Israel was becoming a nation, the evangelical movement was full speed. Oral Roberts, you remember him? He was the movement. Jimmy Swaggart, you remember him? I mean, oh, you're kind of catching on now, ain't you? You remember the PTL club movement? Jim Baker, hello, you remember that? You know why a lot of people don't have nothing to do with God now? Because the motels shut down. And they put air conditioners in a doghouse. Brother, listen, I was in Africa preaching. And I was taking the platform that night, and I was the guest speaker. And the one that was doing my worship that night was the man that used to play the worship in the PTL. Hello? What ironic that is. And I asked him, I said, what are you doing over here in Africa? He said, what are you doing over here in Africa? God told me to come over here and preach. And he wanted to show me a worldview. I said, so what are you doing here? He said, because I'm fed up with the PTL mess. And that mess is coming down. I said, what do you mean? He said, it's a disgrace that when Tammy, hello, when Tammy would walk down to her room, that she would have butlers holding towels waiting for her to step into the pool, and she would take these royal towels off and step in the pool like she's some queen on Sheba. And when Jim would come, it seemed like everybody would just get out of the pool like he was the king from Iran. And he said, I am sick of it. He said, I told him I could not no longer be a part of it. He said, and the more people were sending money, he said, Pastor Moss, you wouldn't believe the hundreds and millions of dollars that people were sending into that ministry. And then what topped it all, this is what made me leave. He said, when they put an air conditioner in her dog's house, he said, I was done. I said, wow, I didn't even know that. He said, oh, yeah. He said, I'm in pursuit for God. Not in the God of materialism and idols that God blessed people with, and then they make idols out of them. See, can you imagine all the people that was involved with the PTL movement? And now you can't even get them to give. They won't come to church. They don't want to have nothing to do with it because they look at all of it as counterfeit. And look, that ain't even scratching the surface. When you look at Billy Graham, when you look at him, that he would have been loyal to everything, but in his own book, he writes himself that he neglected his own family, his own wife, for the sake of souls, was one of his biggest regrets. So even he himself had issues. that he couldn't fix. And then the greatest evangelist of all times is Jimmy Swaggart. They say he had the world in his hand in all the countries of the world. But the women, the lust of the flesh, took the scene and it devastated the whole evangelical world. And you may want to hide in the world because a man do it. You let God take his hand off of you, and I'm going to ask you the same thing. How in the world could you do it? You had the favor of God, you had the wealth of God, you had the blessings of God, and yet you went another way. When God says that the shepherd will smite, will be smitten, and the sheep will scatter, if you notice, every leader on the front line of Christendom, God has smitten them. He's allowed something to happen, and it was scattered the sheep. And now today, there's nothing no greater and no more challenging than trying to win somebody to Jesus Christ because they don't want to hear it. They don't want to hear it. But God said, this is going to be the last blow. He says, I'm going to give you three things, and when you see them, I'm going to open up the fountain. And I'm going to start doing a work that no man can take credit for. Many of you are sitting in here. What I'm fixing to say is very vulgar. It's going to be nasty. It's going to be tough. But you get over it. You say, you need to have more pulpit mannerism, preacher. I'm fixing to get real mannerism. That's the whole world problem. It's isms, isms. Isms. But Jesus said, when you see the abundance of victory, when you see the desecration in the holy place, and when you see it as it was in the days of Noah, he said, you better have your bags packed up. Now that sounds lightly, but it ain't. It's heavy duty. Israel became a nation in 1948. If you look at America and the Industrial Revolution era, America grew to be one of the most powerful countries on the planet. Rome once again rose to the top. A modern day Rome, a modern day Babylon, a world power, world military, wealth, powerful country, made up of 50 states. Powerful country under one head. In God we trust. Christianity, Judaism of our day. We bear his name as the Jews once bore his name. He said, when you see them three things. So 1948 was the budding of victory. You saw Israel. That's to set that part aside. Number two, when you see the desecration of Daniel spoken in Daniel chapter 7, this is what Daniel said. He said, in the place where there is offered to God an offering of praise, which comes from the human heart, come from a place of worship, he said it would become, something would go on the altar, which would be an abomination. Now let me translate that for you in modern terms. Within since 1948, it has came to the surface that the Roman church, the Catholic church, the church, the mother church, the holy one, something that's holy, something that's sacred, something that people can see with the human eyes as an institutionalized that portrays the image of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Virgin Mary and all this stuff. On the altar, which we know that the New Testament teaches that the temple was taken away, as Jesus said, because he was building a new temple, a temple built by not by the hands of men, but by the hands of God, a spiritual temple. But out of the Roman Empire came the Roman church, and it begins to have its wheels that ride itself through the century of time. And all of a sudden, the moment that the desecration on the altar, the Roman church has now been known publicly as molestation of young boys on the altar, which are called altar boys. And they have been molested by the hundreds and thousands in the sacred place. Jesus said, when you see this, you see the temple don't have, the Jews don't have a temple to offer anything on it. But the Catholic Church has a figure type of a temple. Everything they can do it. It all looks like Judaism in its older days in the Old Testament. You got this man walking out with the priest. He's the high priest. Got all his fancy clothes on. He's got his rod. He's walking. There have been so many people that have been raped, molested by the priests on the altar, which is the temple. Your body's the temple of the Holy Ghost. Paul talks about this in Corinthians chapter 3 and chapter 7. How that the temple is the Holy Ghost. If you destroy this temple, God will destroy you, because it's not yours, it's His. You've been bought with a price. You're not your own. It belongs to Him. So therefore, glorify God in your body. But when these boys on the altar doing the sacred things of God and the sacred things, and all of a sudden they're molested by a priest. That's why Zechariah calls them out and says, the priest of the Lord is the one that's doing these things. So therefore, can you imagine the hundreds and millions across the world that the Catholic Church has allowed this to happen to? You couldn't get them kind of people to believe in nothing. They wouldn't put a foot in a church. And now, you thought, oh, it's just the Catholic Church. Oh, no. Oh, no. Called the greatest revival that we know to come out of the Reformation. It was out of Wesley's movement, which is called the Wesleyan Revival, that came from England over to America, that broke out here, in the over here in America. And now, the very movement that brought revival here is the very movement called the Methodist Church that want to debate. They ain't debating anymore. They're going to push it through. That they want to ordain and accept homosexuality. There ain't but a few things in the Word of God that's called an abomination. And Daniel said that the thing that was placed upon the altar was an abominational thing. And Leviticus says if a man led with a man, if he led with a woman, it ain't just a sin, it's an abomination. So when you see these things, it's deeper than culture. It's deeper than Pride Month. You preachers, if you call yourself a true shepherd, you better call it like it is, says the Lord. You got shepherds that are watered down, and they want to be people pleasers because they don't want to lose positions and titles in famous churches. You got mega preachers now that don't preach on sin because they want to see the number. Their numbers of their attendance depicts who they are and their ranks of professionalism of ministry. But I'm here to tell you, you need to understand one thing. You're not accountable to man. You're accountable to God, because He's the one that holds the priesthood. He's the one that sends and calls for. You see all this mess. Zechariah saw it. And he labeled it. He said, the shepherds have led the sheep astray. They have just literally blew my portion. Now when people get blessed of God, they think it's a blessing. But why does it always turn into a curse? Why? Why? God said, and Jesus said, as it was in the days of Noah, so shall it be in coming the Son of Man. They will be building, prosperity, party, marriage, and giving into marriage. In other words, you don't like the one you want, so you dump her and you marry another one. Somebody's been married 4 or 5 times, can't make up. I'm talking universal. And then when 4 or 5 marriages don't work out, you decide to be a lesbian and go gay. I don't condemn a person. I condemn the sin. If you're a lesbian, you need to know Christ. If you're a gay person or practice homosexuality, you need to know Christ. And I know what the form is now. Well, I'm a Christian. God made me this way. Well, can I inform you what the Word of God says in Romans 1? It says that they knew God, which means they know Him and maybe have a relationship with Him, but they do not honor Him. To know God and to read His Word, you honor Him by keeping His Word. Jesus said, if you love me, you will keep my commandments. And if you don't, then you're not honoring me. You really don't love me. You might say you know me, but you don't honor me. You said, Brother Dan, you better hope you don't ever get a child that's that way. Let me just go ahead and tell you. There are a lot of preachers that are dealing with this issue right now. They have children. They have chosen that lifestyle. And it's a lifestyle. It's a culture. They've chosen that. But that's why Jesus said plainly, if you want to be my disciple, you got to forsake mother, brother, you got to forsake son and daughter. You got to have a made up mind whether your youngs go to hell, your mom and daddy goes to hell, and you don't want to go there, and you're going to follow Jesus, you want to serve Jesus, and you got a made up mind. Because when you put your children over God, they become your idol rather than your offspring. Yes. When you worship your children's lifestyle more than you worship the Creator, then you become an idolatrous worshiper. Yes. Evidently, you haven't read the Bible. And you've not seen the land that I've seen where they built the land to have an alternate worship because they didn't want to go to Jerusalem because they knew they would be smitten and cursed by God. So they worship from a distance according to their own rules and regulations. When God said offer it in Jerusalem, He means offer it in Jerusalem. He don't mean that they're in a hill somewhere. Well, I don't have to go to church. Well, why is it written? Some have neglected themselves, assembling themselves together. Why do we assemble ourselves? Because we're just a handful among the minority. We're just a majority. We're just a small group of people when you look at the whole world. The Holy Spirit spoke to me just recently, and I kind of laughed about what He said about in the days of Noah. So, you look like a very intelligent man. That's what most people do. That's what most people do. In the day of Noah, what did he do?
What did Noah do in his day?
He built an ark.
He got drunk.
He built an ark. Can I inform you, as foolish as it may sound, Noah is not here. But his ark is. When God says something, some things He can mean literally when He says it. You see, the lifestyle and the culture of Noah's day is all around us. Just as wicked as it can get every day. But over in a little land called Kentucky, this man wakes up one night and he has a vision of Noah's ark. No, he didn't have a vision. God gave him the vision. Very wealthy men. Very wealthy man. So he decides to build a replica of the ark, specifically to the dimension of the Old Testament. So if God tells you it was in the days of Noah, then you got to have an ark somewhere for you to see the physical ark as a sign in the earth that something is about to happen. So you got an ark in Kentucky that everybody's laughing about. That ark is over there as a sign in the earth. As it was in the days of Noah. We got everything else. We got the preaching. We got all this other stuff going on. But we need an ark to be just like the days of Noah. Now, that ark sitting on there is a laughing stock to a lot of people. But it ain't a laughing stock to God. Because she's going to be sitting there when the rapture takes place. As a sign to the unbeliever. As it was in the days of Noah. So you can't call God a liar. Well, if Noah was here, where is his ark? It's sitting over there. And it sounds crazy, but it's true. The reason people don't worship God is because they don't take Him seriously. But God said in the last days, right now that we're living in, John gives the last call to the people of God in Revelation 18:4. 18:4, this is what John says. This is what the Spirit says. You have took now, 19:4, 1948, Israel of the Nation, the church, as we know it of, has offered on y'all an abomination to God. Even the movement of the church has now accepted those things that are called ungodly and now they're saying it's holy. I had a preacher friend of mine that's a Methodist pastor. He said, I just don't know what to do. I said, well, it's really simple, brother. You're either going to come out from among that mess and stand with God and wait for the departure, and we're back right on the threshold of departure. All of a sudden, and I heard another voice calling from heaven, come away from her, my people. Do not partake in her sins, or you will be punished with her. Now, you're going to make up your mind that your past can't hold you back. You might have been molested. You might have been lied on, cheated on. You may be number three wife, but number three does not define you. You've got women there that compare themselves with other women. There ain't another woman can be this Tina, not another one. She ain't got to compare herself with nobody. She is uniquely and wonderfully and fearfully made back out in her mother's womb. So therefore, there is no comparison. It says, for her sins have piled up as high as the heaven, and God has remembered her evil deeds. You remember the Tower of Babel in the Old Testament? They said, we're going to build a tower, and we're going to become like God, and we're going to be little gods. No, we're going to judge ourselves and be what we're going to be. This whole movement of Pride Month, have you ever heard such of a thing until just recently? Nope. Because these things must come to pass that the scriptures may be fulfilled. That they may, and you've got all these clergy women walking around with these robes on and calling themselves ministers of God, which they're false prophets. They're false prophets. God ain't told you no such a mess. I'll speak to you head on national television. You're corrupt, you're evil, and you're false. Wounded in your own house. If God was to send lesbians and gays through these doors, I would love them because God created the person but not the sins. God said the church needed to weep for these things. Nobody wants to lose a child. Nobody. But let me tell you the day that we're living in. The day that we're living in when men and women speak truth, people are going to walk out. People are going to turn them off and tune them out. But let me tell you something. You're not going to turn God off and tune him out. He said you're either going to come out or you're going to go down with her, and he's going to double her penalty of her evil deed, and it's going to be a brutal part of terror for others, and he's going to give you twice as much judgment. And I know what some of you said. You said, well, why would God do that? Why did he put Israel in Babylon? Why did Israel go into Babylon? Because they violated the Sabbath. And God kept a record of it, and he kept them in number of days, and he kept them 70 years in Babylon because they violated the Sabbath. This generation right here, if I could open up your heart and look into your life, you don't like church because the way the church has treated you. Been hurt, wounded in his own friend's house. But that's why this place ain't called a church. It's called a Shekinah, the house of Shekinah. That's why this is the kingdom, because we're fixing to change worlds. We're fixing to be raptured up out of here. The kingdom come, thy will be done. And we want to be with the Lord where he's at, because he's going to come and deliver Israel the last day of her oppression when all the nations gather around Jerusalem to take Israel out. We are going to descend in Zechariah 14:4. That very place that Jesus stood in the Mount of Olives and he looked over to Jerusalem is the very promise that Zechariah wrote about. And Zechariah knew, he didn't know what he was really doing, but he knew God was speaking to him. So he wrote about Jesus standing in the Olive Garden and looking over to Jerusalem. He saw him standing there. He said the Lord himself will put his foot upon the Mount of Olive. And from the Olive, he will walk across the Kidron Valley and walk into the gates of East again, Jerusalem. I stood there. Straight shot. So God said, because the shepherds are corrupt and they have scattered the sheep. Most of Americans know about Christianity. They know what it means to be a Christian. They might not live like it, but they know, because the sheep have been scattered everywhere. I want you to know that God told Zechariah, he said, you go ahead and speak, because in the midst of all of that, I'm going to bring her out. She glorified herself and she lived in luxury, so she matched with her torment. God says, I'm going to give you tooth for tooth and eye for eye. She boasts in her heart, I'm a queen, and I sit on my throne, and I'm not helpless, and I'm not a widow. I have no reason to mourn. Therefore, these plagues more will take her in a single day, in death and mourning and famine. She will be completely consumed by fire. For the Lord God who judges her is mighty. If you read this right here, you'll see a literal picture of 9/11. In New York City. God dropped them twin towers in 45 minutes. God said he would do it within an hour. You read any article you want to read, in 45 minutes, those twin towers were on the ground. Towers represented the Tower of Babel. Those twin towers represented the commerce of the world, not the summer of the world. The world finances, the world commerce. And they based themselves in New York, Manhattan. I will never forget the day that I was in them towers and looked over into the Hudson Bay and I saw all those ships coming in with all the goods from around the world, those cargoes. I'll never forget when the Lord spoke to me. And I came back and I preached and people laughed at me. 6 months later, them twin towers on the ground. I'm telling you this morning, you better get ready. You better get ready. It might be 6 months, it might be 12, but the Lord is fixing to snatch us up out of here. And he's fixing to judge this messed up mess that's here. You can forget about finding a perfect church, because you sure ain't going to find a perfect church, and you sure ain't going to find a perfect pastor. You're going to probably find one like me. I'm praying and waiting and keeping myself straight, keeping myself clean, because I'm ready for departure. Amen. Got your issues, but this I do know. There was a time in my life when the Lord wasn't dealing with me like he is now. And all of a sudden, I started waking up during the night and having visions and dreams. And there had been about a 15-year span that I didn't feel nothing. Nothing. You know why a dog can bark? Because he's created to bark. You know why people can preach without God? Because they're created to run their mouth about something. Preaching is one thing, but giving the word from God is a whole different number. You're living right now on the threshold of the rapture to take place. I don't believe in the rapture. Well, fine, you go through hell if you want to. I ain't going through hell. I'm going through enough hell. I ain't going through the great tribulation. Because the 7 years of the purging is for Israel, it ain't for the church. I mean, the Bible didn't say in the streets of America, in the middle of Christianity, there's going to be two witnesses preaching for 3.5 years. That ain't what it says. It says in the streets of Jerusalem, the two prophets and two candlesticks would preach for 3.5 years, and then they would be brought down and killed and murdered and laid in the streets for 3 days. But on the fourth day, they're going to come up off the ground. And it's going to be worldwide news, because everybody's going to have one of these jokes right here. YouTube and baby, space chat, Facebook, you name it. Right from Jerusalem. When God said the whole world will see it, he made it possible to see it. He said every nation will see the two witnesses in Jerusalem on the streets laying there dead. And they will witness the resurrection. And as they go up, fear hits all the nations. If you don't believe there's a separation, when you read Matthew 24 and then you read Matthew 25, Jesus said specifically in 24 that these are the things that are coming of the Son of Man. Then he said, Then shall it be like in the earth as the kingdom. Then what? Like the 10 virgins. So the virgins were left. They didn't go up. And who were the virgins? The virgins are separate believers. They weren't ready. You got believer people right now that they're not so. They believe God. They believe Jesus. But they're not worried about his return. They're too busy enjoying idolatry. Enjoying their blessings and their wealth. And this lifestyle that John says, this is how they live. I don't need it. I'm comfortable. Everything's going good for me. I got a nice car. I got a home. I got this. I got that. I mean, everything's cool, man. Everything's cool. But every person in here, if I was to go to individual, there was a point in your life as a Christian that somebody hurt you and you said, the hell with this mess. Forget church. Somebody let you down somewhere along the way. She's shaking her head. Exactly. I'm telling the truth, because I didn't give this message. God gave this message. Many of you in here supposed to be active in ministry, but you're not. Because of some pastor, some leader, circumstances, sideswapped you, and you said, the heck with this. She's being honest. She's going to get her breakthrough today. She's tired of the hurt. She's tired of the mess. All she wants to do is be saturated by God's fire.
Amen.
Oh, my God. What's up? I'm telling you, you're fixing to be released. So much politics in churchiness. I mean, look at this mess. Look at it on TV. Ken Copeland, as good as he is, he's got 6 jets. What's wrong with just having one? I gotta have 6. The spirit of greed at the hands of the girls. Remember Jesus said, buy ourselves. I'm telling you, it's so deep we don't even need it. I'm going to do something that ain't never been done before. Somebody's going to join the church. Who's going to join the church? Come on. But we're fixing to go into a kingdom, an everlasting kingdom, because Judah has got to come forth. And when God says, I will rebuild the ruins of David in his house, what he was saying is, I'm going to look across the earth, and I'm going to do this work in the earth. And Zechariah talks about it in the 4th, in over there in 13, as you continue reading the chapter, he talks about this mighty move of God in the earth, how he's going to take those that have been raped and battered and sexually abused, and you name it all, and have turned from him, he's going to turn their hearts back to him. He's going to cleanse them. He's going to wash them. He's going to fulfill them with his presence. Not with religion, but with a relationship, with an everlasting covenant, which is his spirit. His spirit. And he will never disappoint you. He will never let you down. So you just can't come here and be a part of the kingdom and sit still. He's put a gift in you, in these earthen vessels or treasures. Those treasures belong to him. And he's going to bring forth out of you those things that brings him glory. It ain't about you anymore. It's about his kingdom. I'm as a shepherd is an overseer to see that the word of God is laid out for the sheep, and it's the sheep's responsibility to eat it and go with it. Test everything I say and test it by the word of God and see is it not true feet. Test it. The sad thing, most people in this church that have been in most of their lives don't even understand Zechariah. They don't even understand the staff of faith, the staff of union, how that Zechariah saw us sitting here today being bruised and battered and disappointed by people and circumstances and institutional lives, and yet because we've been battered, we've run from him. All I can tell you is we want to give you the right hand of fellowship. We're all in the kingdom. We're all looking for the second coming of Christ. We're preparing ourselves for his return. We are a remnant of people that have come out from among the world and said, Lord, here am I. Take me, use me, mold me, shape me. So I know this ain't quite what you thought what doing the church was all about, but if I do it any other way, it'll be a man-made or a doctrinated made, but this is God's way. He said, I've saved you to bring you to my kingdom. He said the last thing that would be preached in the earth was not the gospel, but the message for the what? The kingdom. The kingdom. The kingdom. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done. And what's fixing to happen is there fixing to be a catching away. The saints are going to be snatched up. The 7 years of tribulation is going to be set in motion. Israel is going to come under great persecution. And all the nations in the world, when Trump goes out of office and the liberals go in, when I say liberal, the son of perdition goes in, that leader headship is going to turn on Israel. They're going to hate Israel because God has already foreseen it. He's already said it's going to happen that way. And all the nations are going to turn on Israel. And while they're making their plans, we're going to be in the upper room at the Supper of the Lamb. We'll be preparing to come back to Jerusalem. And all of a sudden, when all the nations gather around Jerusalem to take her out, the Lord himself, Zechariah 14 and 4, is going to split the eastern sky. We want to come with the Lord, because the Bible says the Lord himself descends on the earth with all the saints, and all the called out ones will be with him on that day. And then we come down on the Mount of Olives, right there where Jesus stood and prayed, right there where it seemed like he was defeated, but yet he's going to be a conqueror, right there where his wounds were ripped apart when he said, Father, let this cup pass from me. But he said, nevertheless, not my will, but your will be done. He paid a price that day, and the day that is coming, he can stand in the very same place, and we're going to take and protect Jerusalem and Israel and set up the Messianic kingdom. That's what you've been a part of. Not just a little bitty country church out here in the middle of nowhere. Because I'm telling you, when I'm snatched up out of here, and many more snatched up out of here, people in this community are going to run this place to try to find his glory. But you know what happened in days of Noah? When he said, get on the boat, those that got on, and the door was shut.
That's right.
And they were beating on the outside the door. God, let me in your glory. Let me in your glory. Let me in your presence. And you ain't going to hear nothing. You know why you won't hear nothing? Because it is written. If you hear his voice today, if you feel his spirit today, do not turn him away. If you feel God pulling on you, don't turn him away, because it might be your last day. Because the Spirit of God will always strive with you. He will always deal with your hard-headed self. Because he said in Zechariah, he said, I told the people, okay, you don't want me to be a part of your life? Then have at it. Go and destroy yourselves. And when you cry for me, I will not be found. Hello? You're in a critical time, a prophecy of days of fulfillment. These are the days of our Lord. From the time of the budding tree, 1948, to the 70 year of captivity, of the fulfillment of Daniel's prophecy. If you do your 70 years in 1948, it brings you to 2018. From now, moving forward, all these prophecies that you've seen in the Babylonian captivity, Zechariah, Isaiah, Daniel, and Ezekiel, all of them is going to start unfolding real quick. Real quick. Real fast. It's going to just come like waves after waves. It's going to start moving in real quick. Real quick. This ain't what the pastor says. This is what's in this book right here. The problem is people don't read it and they don't know what's in there. I want you to face this congregation. You as a people, as a household of faith, as a body of believers of every tongue, every nation, every race, your obligation to a brother or sister in the faith is to protect, to serve, to encourage, to build up, to love, and to nurse. When they come short, you to embrace them and say, come on, I'm not going to let you lay here. You come on with me. You pick up the wounded and you tow them. You don't leave them in the desert to die.
That's right.
Amen. That's your obligation as a body of believers. I want everybody to stand. Now what I want you to do, and you know why, sister, I'll get it together one day. Get my age, you get it all tangled up. I'm on prayer with both of you. I want you to go stand in that door when everybody walks out. They're going to shake hands, tell you they love you, and they're here for you. And we're going to go and tell the world about the kingdom of God. Zechariah said he's going to set up his kingdom. Daniel 7 says he's going to set up his kingdom. But in the day that he set up his kingdom, that the household of God will be called corrupt. Why? Because you look at the world today. Look at America today. Look at America today. One nation under God. It looks corrupt. It looks like, man, what kind of picture is this? You even got the heathens that are coming over here. You got the Muslim world coming over here. And they're going to start killing you folks. Hello? They're going to start killing you because you don't believe real Christianity. Oh, that's somewhere far off. Oh, no, it's right here in America. You might as well get ready. And I want to see you on the other side. We may depart on this side. I may be raptured up before you do. But we all will be on the other side with our Lord. And we're going to live in Jerusalem. And we're going to establish his kingdom. And we will live on the earth. And I was a little boy, I just said, people die and they float around in the galaxy. That ain't what that book says. That book says, where he is, I shall be. And I will rule and reign with him. If you don't believe, read the book of Ephesians. It says, we will rule and reign with Christ. Where's he going to reign at? What's he going to rule? He's going to reign from Jerusalem. He's going to rule the whole world, which is his kingdom. I'm not going to just float around in a little gas bomb up there somewhere in the heavens. Heaven was not created for man. The earth was created in the fullness thereof. And the Bible says he will create a new heaven and a new earth. So shall we evermore be with the Lord. So I want to encourage you. The journey might require fighting and tears and giving and sacrifice. But in the end, it'll be worth it. His name is Jesus. He's our Lord and he's our Savior. He's Lord over our lives and he's our Savior at the end. When it all comes on us and we feel like we can't take no more, he promised to save us. Father, I pray for my brother and my sister. I pray a prayer of anointing upon their lives, the giftness that you have poured into them, that they have poured out to the body of Christ, to the body of believers. I pray and charge them today in the kingdom that they will go forth in all the world and preach the gospel of the everlasting kingdom to all hearts and souls that they come in contact with. Anoint them with boldness. Anoint them with love and compassion. Mama used her hands and her feet. So wherever you go, let it be said, blessed are the feet of those who bring good tidings, who bring good news of hope and restoration and reconciliation. There's a hurting world and a broken world of humanity. Anoint them for such a time as this to minister to the brokenhearted. Put your compassion in your love and your mercy into their hearts. May they never see what can't be, but may they see what can be. May they take death where it is, in death into sin, and wages of sin is death. Let them speak life to death and say, it shall live again, not by the will of man, but by the will and the power of Almighty God. Anoint them for service in your kingdom, and let them go forth and labor. And when you call them home from their mission, may it be said to them, well done, thou good and faithful servant. Now enter to the rest of our Lord. Father, I charge them in the presence of these people, in the presence of angels that are encamped about us right now that we can't even see, that are watching over us in this meeting, and they witness the things in heaven working in the things of the earth. I charge them right now in your presence, and in the presence of your Son, and of the Holy Spirit. And everybody said,
amen.
Amen and amen. If you two will go back to the back door, and everybody's going to meet you and greet you on the way out. Now to the rest of you, I charge you to leave this place today to go and tell the world about us.